Monday. It is October 26th, the last week of the month of October, 2015. This is Wayne Goldsboro Television. I'm Wayne Alley.
And I'm Kate Daniels.
Hello there.
Hello, Wayne.
I hope you had a nice weekend.
We did. We had a great weekend.
The weather was fantastic. I love it. And we didn't mention this last Friday, but last Thursday was a big event.
It was.
Wall Lane Tree. It was a big event, and congratulations to everyone, you and everyone associated with that, because it was a fantastic event. Give us a capsule, brief thing.
Sure.
Tell us what happened.
Well, it was the annual Leading Wayne Leadership Luncheon. So we have done this for 5 years prior to this year, so this marked the sixth one. We had a great panelist discussion by Scott Stevens, Shelby Benton, Dr. Dunsmore, and Colonel Slavik. It is the format, you know, it's like anything, you know, you want to make it better. And this format has been in place the past 3 years. And it is four questions. And it is an inside look into leadership styles, tough decisions. It's all about empowering the attendees on how they can become a better leader. You know, we've talked about this in prior weeks about, you know, there's all kinds of leaders in this world. And, you know, you've got the skills deep down inside of you. And some people it bubbles up more, and others, you know, you just need that realization. And I left there, and I felt like the other attendees did, totally recharged.
Yeah, it was.
Absolutely recharged. That was an introduction of this year's Leadership Wayne class.
Right.
We've got 20 business leaders that are part of this 9-month program. So they were introduced. And the annual Duke Energy Citizenship and Service Award was presented. Now, this is highly regarded secret.
Very much.
I do not like keeping secrets. It is very tough when there's great news to share.
Yeah.
And this year, Millie Chalk presented the award to Mike Haney.
Mike Haney.
And for those of you watching that know him, you're shaking your head and going, absolutely well deserved. For those of you that do not know him and his history in Wayne County, successful businessman for 26 years, joined the Development Alliance. Instead of retiring, he said, I'm going to the Development Alliance. And he was the specialist who worked with all the large companies here in town. He kept the relationships up. He's been a part of many, many, many groundbreakings that generated millions of dollars in our community. And certainly was at the helm 8 years ago of the Works Initiative. And he, along with some other great partners from the county commissioners, with Wayne Community College, lots of other partners, now Wayne County is able to boast that not only were we the first in the state to be Work Ready certified, but also, on top of that, 27% of the workforce in Wayne County has received CRCs, that they are workforce ready.
Yes.
So he has been involved in so much, the chamber, the military affairs, just a lot of work in the community. So the presentation today was very fitting, and in true leadership form, Mike Haney received it. He was speechless for a few moments, and then what did he do? He immediately turned around and started talking about the other people who have been with him along the way to make, you know, all this stuff happen. I mean, it's never about, that's the great thing about leaders, it's never just about them.
It wasn't a
one-man show. So he's a humble man. He has recently retired from the Wayne County Development Alliance. So congratulations for that. And the chamber is very thankful because he is currently a board member. And instead of rolling off of his term as a retiree, he said, no, I'll stay on.
Yeah.
So that's wonderful. We benefit.
Yeah.
So
it was
a great day, and we appreciate you being there and filming it.
True.
And look forward to it.
We're going to show that later this week as
well.
It was a great event, and I think it'll make good TV because it was just very interesting. Those were four great leaders of our community, in our community. In fact, four great leaders, period. Regardless of where they are. And, of course, Mike Haney, well-deserving of that recognition and that award. All right, we're going to move on to our interview here in just a moment. I do want to mention birthdays first. Jacqueline Smith, you remember her? One of Charlie's Angels?
I do.
Yeah, she's a pretty brunette. She is now a spokesperson for, she's been a Kmart spokesperson for
long time. There is a trend with the name birthdays he selects, I've decided. If they're female, they're not bad looking. Is that a fair statement?
Well, it's a coincidence.
Total coincidence.
Yeah. And then there's Pat Sajak of Wheel of Fortune, who works with a very lovely lady.
Okay. He does.
Anyway, Jacqueline Smith is 70 and Pat Sajak is 69 today.
Really?
Lauren Toos was on Love Boat. She played Julia. Julia on Love Boat. Rita Wilson was in the movie Sleepless in Seattle, Runaway Bride, It's Complicated. Viola in The Good Wife, on TV, The Good Wife. She plays Viola. She's 59 today. Patrick Breen was in the movie Men in Black. He's on Madam Secretary. He plays Andrew. Andrew is 55 today, Patrick Breen. Dylan McDermott. Now, you may know who that is. He was in the movie In the Line of Fire with Clint Eastwood. He was in the movie, the TV show The Practice. He's done a lot of stuff, but I found something very interesting about Dylan McDermott. If you don't know who he is, if you know him, if you saw him, you'd know him.
Sure.
I got to tell you this. It's a fascinating story. His name is Mark Anthony McDermott.
Okay.
He was born in Waterbury, Connecticut. Mom and dad, she was 15 and his father was 17. The father earned money by hustling pool.
Okay.
In 1967, when Dylan McDermott was five years old, his mother was murdered by her live-in boyfriend.
Oh.
By her live-in boyfriend. The murder was initially ruled an accidental shooting occurring while her boyfriend cleaned his gun, but police reopened the case in 2012 and revealed evidence showing it was impossible for her death to have been accidental. Now, Dylan and his sister Robin, who was then 6 months old, were taken in by their grandmother. When he was 15, his father, who was still living, met and married a playwright named Eve Ensler. Eve Ensler adopted Dylan, kind of took her under his wing, took him under her wing. She encouraged him to go to acting school and go to Fordham University in New York. He changed his name from Mark to Dylan in tribute to her.
Oh, wow.
Eve Ensler, who suffered a miscarriage and who would have given her own child that name, Dylan. So he loved this woman so much, he adopted that name. Dylan and Eve have an extremely close and caring relationship to this day. Anyway, if you're a Dylan McDermott fan, and a lot of people are, that's something that I thought was very interesting there. Okay, we'll be right back.
Your source for what's happening in your community is Wayne Goldsboro Television.
And get your attention, we'll get started. And Julie says this will be a nice ceremony, but we don't want to keep you here too long. We want to let you wander down Center Street. For those who don't know me, I am Scott Stevens, Goldsboro City Manager. It really is an honor for me to be here, but I want to thank all of you for being here. This is really a first for the city and downtown. Who would have thought a public art installation ceremony? My background is engineering, I would have never dreamed it. So again, it's a good day for us. I would like to share at least a short version of how we got to where we are today. In 2006, we began a downtown master plan, and while Allison Platt, over here to my left, helped shape the recommendations of the final document, ultimately our city council had unanimously adopted this plan back in 2007. It was the input of the people that participated in the process that helped identify the needs and allowed her to present that plan to the city council. During this process and the years that followed, we had dozens of public input opportunities where we listened and made adjustments and finally created construction plans. Knowing we had a Tiger 5 grant funding to help support the Streetscape Project, which was recommended in the downtown master plan, helped us to make the project more than what we could have done alone. And since we had a roundabout at Ash Street and another one planned for Walnut Street, it made sense from a cost and traffic flow standpoint perspective to have a roundabout, its Chestnut and Mulberry Streets as well. Then came the question as to what to design for these spaces. And since downtown is growing into a recognizable art-based economic environment, public art was an interest. But the city did not wish to be the sole body to make the determination of how and what. So a public art steering committee was formed, a committee made up of local artists, business owners, city staff, DGDC Design Committee, and Historic Committee members. They began meeting in January of this year and helped make the decision to lease art instead as opposed to acquiring a permanent collection.
You film me?
This was a cost-effective option for the city, and it will assure continual interest as the pieces may change each year. They also worked with a consultant to identify available lease options, narrow that selection based on scale, present size and volume, and diversity, and then made a selection of 11 pieces that were made available on the city's website to allow for public input in this process. We shared this opportunity on the city and DGD's Facebook pages, downtown newsletters, and our mass email newsletters, as well as other venues. The three most favorite options are being installed or have been installed today. And additionally, a group of local community members acquired an additional lease piece that will be installed at a later, or I guess later today as well. We are excited to have the artists here today. Our comments, the mayor and I, as well as the Public Art Steering Committee members, will present each artist, or after my comments, we'll present each artist with a plaque that will be placed near each piece for the year. And I encourage you to walk down Center Street if you've not done so yet today, and enjoy these pieces that have been installed. And again, have the opportunity, if you're around, to meet the artists whose creation they are. So with that, I will turn it back over to Julie and move from there. But thanks again for being here.
Yesterday when I sent out the email reminder to invite you all to this ceremony, I almost said, come see what all the fuss is about. Have you ever heard the quote, if you don't like change, you're going to like irrelevance yet less? With this project has come a lot of discussion about the changes taking place downtown. Some love it and some do not, or at least they don't think so right now. While we understand change is difficult and can be rather uncomfortable, we also believe that downtown has needed some change for some time. Yes, we are blessed to have historic roots and a wealth of historic architecture, something we value greatly downtown. This embodiment of history has shaped us to date and serves as the foundation for our efforts. But this does not mean we can't and shouldn't embrace more modern elements and changes to the downtown. Downtowns are meant to be more than a history museum. They are organic and, if suppressed, can die. In order to keep people, particularly younger people, interested, engaged, and hopefully invested, it needs to be diverse, interesting, and relevant. I commend those people in our community that have worked so hard to better our downtown, whether through preservation efforts, events, or loyally supporting our downtown businesses. Their work has given us the ability to be where we are today. Yes, change is uncomfortable. Do we individually have to like every individual change? I don't think so. Should we expect to? Again, I don't think so as well. It's the collective change that makes a difference. Downtown is and should be something bigger than each of us, and taste is always subjective and individual. What I've loved about this whole process, this last 14 months, throughout all the discussions about who likes what and who doesn't like what, is this. We're all beginning to talk about downtown again. Young, old, diehard downtown veterans, and those with newer, renewed interests, this is exciting to all of us. Art can do that. It is thought-provoking and interesting. So with that in mind, I'm excited to introduce members of the Public Art Steering Committee, a group of people Scott alluded to earlier that were specifically formed by the city to help make the decision of what selection of art pieces to choose and how to go about doing it. They are, if they are in the audience, if they'll please step forward, Jennifer Collins, Senior Planner with the City of Goldsboro, Allison Platt, Urban Designer and Project Designer for Center Street, Randy Guthrie, Assistant City Manager, local artist Taylor Shoup. Taylor, where are you? There you are. Downtown business owner Mifta Ali. Local artist Randy Wright. Sarah Merritt, Arts Council Director. Bethany Perry, DGDC Design Committee Member. And of course myself. And I also have to thank Jim Davis, our consultant of Cary, North Carolina. He's with Sculpture in the Landscape. He helped us throughout this process, and we couldn't have done it without his help. Thanks, Jim. I'll now turn it over to Mifta to share a brief introduction of The Natural Embrace by Paul Hill. She'll be followed by Taylor Shoup, Randy Wright, and Allison Platt.
Greetings, everyone, and welcome. I'm so honored to introduce Paul Hill and his amazing art piece entitled Natural Embrace. Paul studied fine art at Kent State University. He served in the military, and he also was an art director for the commercial world. And we're so glad he gave all that up to create beautiful art, awesome art. The piece called Natural Embrace is based on the tiny, beautiful, humble, yet mighty Venus flytrap. The Venus flytrap, amazingly enough, grows only in one small area in North Carolina, and I heard maybe even on the East Coast. So we're excited to have this represented in downtown Goldsboro. The sinuous stems are based on Core 10 steel, and the flytrap itself is green and clear fused glass, which allows the reflective light to shine through beautifully. We're also proud that this piece was represented as the best of show in the Cary Sculpture Exhibition. So that's pretty amazing. I'm personally excited about this piece because it's right in front of my storefront window and I gaze at it every single day. So I'm very honored for that. Paul's art can be seen all over the world. So welcome to Goldsboro. We're happy to have you.
How are you all doing? My name is Taylor Shoup, local artist, and this is an honor to be a part of the steering committee. Not only are these sculptures just interesting and engaging on their own, but they serve as kind of a beacon for a society that is kind of accepting of the arts and culture, and I think that's very important. It's a huge step for Goldsboro. I have the pleasure of introducing Nathan. He is responsible for Dreamsicle, which is at the roundabout at Chestnut and Center. And it's a beautiful piece, and I hope you all get to see it here shortly. Nathan is here joining us from Missouri. He is born and raised in Cape Girardeau. He obtained his arts education, or his BFA in sculpture from Southeast Missouri State University. Nathan was brought up in a middle-class home with four brothers and sisters. His father is a third-generation stonemason, and this taught him the value of craftsmanship. From his experience, he grew an appreciation for the working man as well as a passion for building things with his hands. His sculptures reflect not only his personal interest in architectural form, but also a belief that communication plays a fundamental role in our perception of the world around us. His work has always dealt with the conflicts of confinement and freedom and exploring catalysts between the two, building and destroying communication. I'm going to borrow some of Nathan's words now and talk about his process. The material I use in the process of my work is directly influenced by experience. I come from a Midwest blue-collar family that has been in the construction business for generations, and the idea to create sculpture from those same materials seemed natural and permanent. My decision to utilize the benefits of structural steel in my work also comes from being inspired by the fabrication process. I enjoy the dedication and commitment that is required with this material that helps build character. About Dreamsicle, Nathan says, "In this modern world where we constantly feel more connected through advancements in technology, I believe that we are simultaneously disconnected as a result of these devices. By using public art as a vehicle for expressing contemporary issues concerning communication, I see the concept for my work becoming more relevant every day. Through the radiating spokes of my abstracted satellite forms, I hope to engage the viewer's curiosity in my public interaction." Nathan, thank you very much for bringing your work to Goldsboro. It's beautiful. It's definitely going to inspire some conversation, and it raises the art community. Thank you very much.
Hello. I'm Randy Wright. I am on the committee, obviously, and I'm also a local artist. I'm here. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to be able to serve on this committee. Is that close enough? Serve on this committee. So, Julie, thank you, and Sarah, thank you also. I have the honor of recognizing Phil Hathcock. He's an artist from Cary, North Carolina, who created a piece called titled "The Flight." It's going to be down here on our left down here. And it's at the entrance of John Street parking lot off of Center Street. Phil's expertise and artistic abilities are well known and established. Whether it be the ability to recreate natural landscapes or his gift to creating sculptures from stone in combination with other materials, anyone familiar with his talents finds it difficult not to leave without involving some form of work at their home or a workplace. As far back as Phil can remember, he always loved nature. If he could be outside, that's where you would find him. And Phil's in the yellow shirt right back over there, everybody. So you know who I'm talking about at this point. He loves his love of rocks and boulders and the many ways that it seemed to push up through the ground and the new shapes and formations that they would turn into led Phil into a career of working with stones that began at age 17. During many years working with stones, Phil has made use of every opportunity to travel, travel the world and study many different formations and rock formations. How they have been modified and used and combined with all the information that he has. His style is recognizable. Anytime you see his stuff, you can recognize that it's Phil's. So Phil, thank you for bringing your stuff here. Everybody.
Hello everyone, I'm Allison Platt and I'm a member of the Public Art Steering Committee and the landscape architect for the Center Street Project. And, and I'm so happy to be here today. This is a great day for all of us, I think. And I'd just like to say that I had the opportunity to design this space, but I wouldn't have had that opportunity without all of you people in Goldsboro believing in making your town better. Sometimes in towns I work, I get the opportunity, sometimes I don't. And I'm very blessed to have had the opportunity here, and I thank you all for that. I'd just like to say that the Public Art Steering Committee was a really good group to work with, and it was a really good process, and we also had that public input component of it. So I think as time goes by that people will really understand and appreciate this art. Well, the other thing I'd like to say is this was a private donation for this piece. And it was basically Betty Duncan, David Hamm, Barbara Wright, and myself. And we did this because we wanted people to get excited about the fact that they can have a role to play in choosing art for downtown. And we'd like to really, really encourage individuals and groups and corporations in Goldsboro in the future to consider sponsoring some of the smaller pieces that could go downtown, because it's only going to add to the richness of our downtown. So I'd like to encourage that. I had the honor today of recognizing Charles Pilkey. Where are you, Charles? Oh, there he is, right there. He's an artist from Mint Hill, North Carolina, who created the piece titled Genesis. This piece was leased by us, and it's down in the next median park on the next block across from the John Street parking lot. So go take a look at it. It's a beautiful piece. A little information about Charles. He's a writer, illustrator, and artist who began as a geologist and is now living in Mint Hill. He lived in Japan for 14 years, where he taught stone carving classes at Kyushu Sangyo, I hope I get that right, University. His sculptures can be seen in China, Italy, Japan, Korea, Turkey, and the U.S. He dreams of one day carving stone on the moon. He received his formal education from the University of Missouri, an MFA in sculpture, from ECU, a BFA in sculpture, and from the University of Wisconsin, a BS in geology. Charles' work is a reaction to the central issues of our times, our burgeoning technology. And a bit about this particular piece, and I'm quoting him here, each material has its own voice. I like stone because it comes from the earth and thus provides a much needed spiritual link to nature. Moreover, because of the unmoving, timeless qualities of the material, viewing stone sculpture can slow us down, offering rest in a hectic age of burgeoning technology and counterpoise to an ill-considered pursuit of the latest digital gadgetry. Stone is ancient beyond imagining, yet still has a role to play in modern life. Genesis is inspired by the tribal arts of West Africa and Celtic Ireland that deal with the themes of life, birth, and growth. The form and title also suggest the idea of cosmic creation. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I always get the easy part. These speakers who preceded me, they've done the heavy lifting, and I get to do the easy stuff. They have a lot of respect and pity on me. So I'm so proud of this team who put all of this stuff together. You know, before I get started, let me recognize some of the culprits who are responsible for this, not just Alfie. Chuck Allen, council member, is here, Mayor Pro Tem. Bill Broadway is here.
and Gene Acock. These are council members who are partly responsible for some of this, but I've been looking for the major culprits. All morning I've been walking down the street trying to find out who's responsible for tearing our city up and having all this dust. People can't park, and merchants can't have people who park in front of their businesses. Who did that? I think I found the answer. They've appeared here on this podium, most of them. And I'm so proud of what they've done. Let me start with Allison Platt. She's awesome. We decided, I guess right after I became mayor, that we needed to do something about Goldsboro. We needed a master plan. And we looked around and this name, Allison Platt, popped up as a person who's been doing this all over the country, and she has a great reputation. I said, let's get her. We contacted Allison. She came down. She had a meeting with us right up here in my conference room. And we told her we want a plan that will take us down the road for the next 30 years. And we wonder if she's up to that. And boy, was she up to that. She jumped on that like, I won't say what, but she jumped on that. And I think about the second meeting she came to discuss this project with us, she mentioned to me, Mr. Mayor, you know, I could move. I could live in Goldsboro. I said, oh, yeah, sure you can. She lived in Baltimore, Maryland. And the last meeting we had, she said, you know, Mr. Mayor, I bought a house in Goldsboro, and I'm moving to Goldsboro. And you have access, listen to this, access to free information. Well, I have so much access to free information, and I'm very leery when I hear that. But coming from Allison Platt, I jumped all over that. And she's lived up to her word. Allison, thank you for coming to Goldsboro to monitor this project from day one. So I knew you had a hand in this, but there are other culprits that I've been trying. And if I look around here now, see these guys back here, the dynamic duo. I don't have to, they are right there. I'm not going to call their names because you wouldn't recognize them. But it's the dynamic duo. And the Perry's here, you know, that's David and Bethany Perry. We have an airplane down here at the north end. And boy, is it doing wonders. It will bring attention to downtown. Now, if we could get you to move your house at the south end and just put it on something and move it down there, we'd have something to anchor the south end. So you don't have to answer us right now. Just think about it before you say no, okay? Seriously, we have so many people who we need to appreciate for this. And I want you to know, as one person out here, I definitely appreciate what you've done. I appreciate it so much until I feel now that I can walk away from this job and I can feel comfortable that we are turning it over to people who love the city and who are going to continue. We're not there yet. We got a lot more stuff to do. And the new board that's going to come in, let me tell you, they are going to really finish this job for us. Again, I can see so many people who, Martha Bryan, Martha, thank you. She has been with us all the way. And I hate to start naming names, but I'll stop now. But if you're out here, I want to thank you for making this dream come true. So on behalf of all of our citizens, it's my job. They all can't be here, but they speak through me. And I'm proud to say to all of you, on behalf of our citizens, thank you. Thank you for saving our downtown.
Thanks for watching. This is Wayne Goldsboro Television, in the heart of Goldsboro, in the heart of Wayne County.
Okay, today's Monday, all right. Coming up Sunday, November 8th, I got to tell you about this. I'm a big band fan.
Uh-huh.
I love big band music. And there's a group here in the Wayne County area known as the Starlight Dance Band. And I have some friends with the Starlight Dance Band, and one of those guys is Doug Tart.
Okay.
And the other guy is Roger Walker. Now, Roger was a high school band leader for many years, but he's done so many other things for youth in the Wayne County, in Eastern North Carolina, all of Eastern North Carolina. But now, coming up, there's going to be a Battle of the Bands. We're talking about band music here, a Battle of the Big Bands. That's coming up Sunday at 3 p.m., November 8th, in Fletcher Recital Hall at ECU in Greenville. Admission's only $15 to the general public. Now, ECU students with an ID and high school age children or young adults and younger get in free. If you want ticket information, you can go to 1-800-ECU-ARTS or go to ecuarts.com. This is going to be a major event. Two big bands. Now, one is the Starlight Dance Band here in Wayne County. The other is a band in Pitt County known as the Emerald City Big Band. Mm-hmm. And I love big band music. We're talking about music of the 30s and 40s and 50s. Yeah, I won't begin to name them. But again, that's ecuarts.com, November 8th, starting at 3 p.m. And they're trying to raise money. This is money for.
What is the goal?
They're raising money for scholarships to help children, young people get into ECU's music department. Helping the kids get into music.
That's so you can support Wayne County talent, all while giving an opportunity
exactly
to
right
other students. Who need, you know, some assistance along the way.
Yes.
Give them opportunity.
And I know you know this. There is a tremendous amount. Every time, I'm always shocked, or not shocked, but I'm surprised at the amount of outstanding talent.
Oh, I'll
here
say
in Wayne
it.
County.
I'm constantly amazed.
I am as well.
I did not drink the same water as some of these individuals growing up, apparently. They are wonderful. Their reputation is incredible. So if you are able to go to ECU coming up on November 8th, please do.
That's right.
Go support them. And you know, it wasn't but a week ago, Casey Sutton was on the front page of the newspaper.
Yeah, I saw that.
And she is the daughter of Rick Sutton,
right,
who is over Crime Stoppers here in town. And if you're watching this and you know who she is, you are shaking your head and going, she's amazing.
She is
quite incredible. The Crime Stoppers fundraiser, I know that y'all did several interviews leading up to that. It was the gospel thing. It was the fundraiser. It's been probably close to a month ago. She sang, I'm not kidding you.
Are you kidding?
I closed my eyes.
Yeah.
Okay, she covered two Carrie Underwood songs.
Okay.
I closed my eyes. And she sounded better than Carrie Underwood.
Sounded better.
I'm saying that. And
woo!
Carrie Underwood is flawless.
Oh, yeah.
Casey Sutton is. She is just a blessed young woman. And
not
only does she have the talent, she's got the heart.
She has. She
underneath
has
it. And she's got the passion. And she is a Christian woman who is using her talents. And, you know, anyone who hears it benefits. So if you didn't get to see that article, you can Google her and see what she's up to. And Wayne County, we need to get behind her.
Oh, no question about that.
Yes.
But she can, how do they say it, belt one out there. She can belt one out of the
park. And it's like she's
out of the
just
park
talking. Like it just
yeah,
is
it
effortless.
Just flows. It just, she's
I
really
sing happy
proud
birthday and my face looks like it's draining.
Okay.
Just being honest.
Okay, let's see.
Just being honest.
Today's the 29th.
Now, you know, Friday, we're coming up on Halloween weekend.
Yes.
Friday in downtown, zombies are taking over.
No.
They are. Zombies are taking over.
Real zombies.
This is a very neat initiative that Beth Ann and some fine folks from Dancing Butterfly have put together, this idea of having a zombie performance.
Whoa.
To Thriller, and it's going to be downtown on Friday evening.
Is this going to be like a flash dance?
Uh-huh. It's a flash mob.
Flash mob, not flash dance. That was a movie.
Flash
mob.
Flash dance does not sound appropriate.
Flash mob, yeah.
But there, and I don't know how many people are part of this cast, but I've seen pictures online of them practicing, and it's full out makeup, costume, choreography. Get your family and come out if you can.
That's going to be great.
Isn't that neat?
Yes.
It's very neat. I wish we could have participated. I was going to see if my 5-year-old daughter and I could do it together, but We just couldn't commit to some of the time performances, so we're going to go watch.
That will be fun. That will be a lot of fun. You know, they paved downtown Goldsboro Center
yes.
Street over the last, what was it, Thursday and Friday,
Friday.
And
mm-hmm.
then did some striping and all that. So it's ready, and coming up next Monday, a week from today, they're going to have the ribbon cutting to
That's
open,
right.
officially open Center Street downtown Goldsboro.
That's Ooh. Right, which is very exciting. And, you know, Center Street never closed down completely.
No,
and it
didn't.
Has been a bear and difficult for a lot of the businesses, mm-hmm. but the city of Goldsboro has done a wonderful job working with the construction teams
mm-hmm.
and working with the businesses to minimize the impact. Though certainly with something like this, you can't go without there being some impact. So this celebration could not come soon enough for everybody. Come on out and show some support and just
November 7th.
how much better is our community for how this is what this is going to do.
Next Monday. That's exactly
yes, Monday.
Right. I said today's the 29th. Today's the 26th. It's
when you
Monday.
Said that, I was like, I am late.
Yeah, no.
For everything.
For everything.
For a couple of days.
Okay, the 26th. Today is National Mincemeat Day. I'm not a mincemeat fan necessarily, but somebody may be. Anyway, it's your day if you are. You know, we're out of time.
That's it.
Yeah, we got to go. We'll be back in here tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock. And again, that show repeats at noon and at 5:30 p.m. here on Wayne Goldsboro Television. So until tomorrow, I'm Wayne Alley.
And I'm Kate Daniels.
And this is Wayne Goldsboro Television.